Okay, as the instructions say, on a previously teared beaker, I poured in enough of my unknown copper-containing compound to about approximately 2 grams. You'll notice the rich blue color that many copper 2-ion-containing compounds have. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to add about 10 milliliters of water just to dissolve my compound. I'm going to use a stir rod to get that dissolved. All right. I want to concentrate everything in the bottom of the beaker because later on when I heat, I want to prevent a lot of splattering from happening. All right. So I'm going to dissolve my copper compound. I may have to add a little more water to do that. After you have dissolved your unknown copper compound in distilled water, you're going to now add 6 molar sodium hydroxide to get your chemical reaction going. Typically, you're going to find reactants such as these on a cart in the lab room, some part of the lab room. A couple of things are important. Number one, pay attention to the instructions. If it says about 10 milliliters, that means you don't have to make a very precise, super accurate measurement. It's not 10.00. So a regular graduate cylinder you might have handy will work. Couple other things, whenever you're gonna deal with these reactants that are placed for you, one important thing is never let the lid touch the surface of the bench or the cart. So always first loosen it up and then grab it between your little finger and the palm of your hand and hold the lid in there. Now, you're gonna be ready to pour down here. Now, in this case, what I'm gonna do is they gave us a little dispenser pipette. It looks like this. Okay, it's like a big dropper thing. So I'm gonna take up some of my stuff and I'm going to pour it in there very carefully. And make sure that I get about 10 milliliters approximately. Like I said, it doesn't have to be very exact. Now, let's say that the amount to be dispensed were something like 25, 30, 40 milliliters. In that case, that is a very slow method, so you want to pour. Now remember, whenever you're going to pour, again, make sure you're holding the lid, the cap, in your between your finger and your palm of your hand, and you want to pour, you know, kind of like deliberately. Don't kind of try to slowly trickle it down, because as we'll see later on, such are the cohesion forces of water molecules that they want to hold on to each other, and what will happen is the liquid will basically dribble down the side of the bottle instead of being poured. All right, so we're going to close that, and now we have our 10 milliliters of NaOH. Okay, I have my copper compound dissolved in water. Again, you can see the rich blue color of the solution that was made. And now I'm ready to add my 6 molar sodium hydroxide solution just to get the chemical reaction going. When it says slowly, there are several ways you can go about it. If you have a dropper, you can use a dropper and add it dropwise. Or you can also let it slide down the glass rod using the slide rod, kind of like a conduit, to carry the liquid sodium hydroxide solution down into the beaker. All right, so we're gonna do that like that. Just very carefully, I'm gonna slide it down there. And as you can see, the solution starts acquiring a deeper blue color. And that's chemistry you'll get to learn about later on. And it starts precipitating because now the originally copper 2-ion has been taken into an insoluble copper 2-hydroxide compound. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to use my squirt bottle of distilled water to rinse down, you know, some of that stuff that was left on the stir rod when I was stirring. Make sure I got everything there in the bottom of the beaker. And now I'm going to turn on the hot plate.
Notice that there's two controls. One is for stirring, which we're not going to use, and the other one is for heat. So I want to turn it on a little high at first. I want to make sure that I don't have this thing boiling, and I'm going to cover it with a watch glass to make sure that if it does start splattering, it won't go out onto the hot plate or onto the bench. All right, so we're going to start at about a high temperature. Be patient. And once you see it start kind of wanting to boil, kind of like having bubbles out or maybe jumping a little bit, turn the heat down to keep constant heat but avoid splattering. All right? At this point, the mixture has started to boil, so I turn the heat down here to the low rate region of the control. The other thing you can observe is that the mixture inside the beaker is getting darker and darker. This is the copper 2 oxide product, which has a dark color in comparison to the other copper 2 containing compounds that had the bright blue. Again, notice that there's minimal bubbling, minimal jumping. I want to make sure there's no splattering. If some splattering happens, what I'll have to do is I'll have to lower the heat even more. And this only takes like, you know, about a minute or so before it starts. So you don't have to worry about, you know, sitting there for an hour waiting for the reaction to happen. You can see how it's all turning dark color. We're going to just watch it visually until there's no more blue left over. Okay. Again, notice that it's bubbling hardly, so I'm going to turn the heat down a little more just to make sure that I don't get any splattering all over the place. And I'm just going to wait visually until all of the blue color is gone. Be careful. The beaker gets hot, and so is the top of the hot plate, so don't put your hands in there. What we're going to do is once it has finished reacting, we are going to turn off the heat altogether. Okay, so I'm going to kind of very carefully swing it around a little bit, check around. Okay, so that should pretty much be done. I'm going to turn off the heat altogether, and I'm going to let it sit there for maybe like something like 5 minutes to allow it to cool down a bit. And once it stops splattering, I'm probably going to take off the watch glass to allow it to cool a little faster also. I don't want to do anything else until the whole mixture has cooled down to room temperature. And my next step is going to be to filter this reaction mixture. For the next step in the procedure, we're going to take our reaction mixture and filter it. Filtration is a method that we use to separate components of a heterogeneous mixture. We basically separate out the liquid phase of the mixture from the solid phase. So what I have here is a ring stand with an iron ring support. On top of the ring support, I'm going to put a clay triangle that I'm going to use to hold this glass funnel in there. What I'm going to use to filter the mixture is a regular filter paper that usually comes in the form of a disc. There are several ways of taking this and turning it into a cone shape that we can fit onto the glass funnel. The way I do it is very simple. I just take it one fold down the half, and then I fold it there. Make sure you don't crease it with your fingernails because you might introduce tears into the paper, and then do a second fold here to generate like what looks like a, I don't know, like a slice of pizza or watermelon. And then what you do is you can open it down the middle on one side or the other, and that gives you a cone shape. I'm going to put it in the glass funnel, but to hold it in place, I'm going to moisten it with some water. Let me put a beaker underneath to collect the filtrate. And now that I have it in here, I'm going to moisten it with distilled water just to make sure that the whole thing sticks in there. All right, and I get it moist. And that will hold the filter paper in place. Okay, so here we go. We have our filter paper in there, and we can already see some of the moisture, some of the water dripping through. This is done by sheer gravity. So it is a slow process, but what it does is it kind of like gives you a very good recovery of your material, because by gravity, very little of your solid, even if it's small particulate matter, is gonna kind of like filter through. Okay, we've allowed our reaction mixture to cool down sufficiently. It looks like has a very dark color. I wanna make sure that I got everything that's in here. I'm gonna rinse down the sides a little bit over here. And then very carefully, I'm gonna use my stir rod as a guide to pour it down the middle of this funnel here so that it drops right in the center of that cone in there. I'm gonna pour it down there into the filter paper. It should start dripping right away. And now to get the rest of the stuff that's in here, I wanna use my squirt bottle to squirt down all this rest of the stuff here and also down the glass stirring rod. All right, I wanna get this in here very quickly, pour it down there. Try to get all of it in there. All right, so I got all my stuff in there, and then I'm gonna give it one last squirt of water on the tip of the glass rod itself so I can get everything in there. Now, the process is slow because it's by gravity, so you can see it dripping down the bottom there. Now remember, the more liquid you had to filter, the longer it's gonna take. That is why we told you to not add too much water when you first dissolved your copper-containing compound, all right? And that's why we're limiting how many rinses you do of the stuff here. Realize as it's dripping that you are trying to get rid of the excess sodium hydroxide, because after this is all filtered, we're gonna dry the filter paper with our copper 2 oxide product in here. And the thing with that is that you wanna make sure you get rid of all the excess sodium hydroxide. Otherwise, once the water evaporates, some of that residual sodium hydroxide will also stay there and affect our calculations. Okay, so we're gonna let this finish filtering. When it finishes, we're gonna rinse the filter paper with a few milliliters of distilled water again so we can finish wrapping it up, all right? Okay, we are done with our filtration. We did a rinse of water. And now we're gonna use a small pair of pliers to pull the paper out of here. Remember that when we started, this paper had been pre-weighted, right? You had pre-weighted that paper, you had that on your data sheet. And now very carefully, I'm gonna pull it out of here. And I am going to bring it around and I'm gonna put it on a watch glass. That should be clean. Some students like to leave it like this. Some of them like to spread it out a bit, because what we're gonna do now is we're gonna just dry that paper in an oven overnight just to remove all of the residual water that's in there. One of the things you wanna check for before you leave is sometimes when we do the rinse, perhaps you were a little too eager, too enthusiastic about the water, and you might have accidentally caused some of your stuff to splash between the filter paper and the glass funnels. You wanna inspect to make sure your glass funnel is clean, that didn't happen. Also, your filtrate should be very clean. There should be no black or blue stuff in it. If there is, that means that A, if you have some blue stuff, it means you did not have a complete reaction. If you have black stuff, it means that your filtration leaked somehow. So be aware of those kind of things as possible sources of error. We are now gonna take our watch glass, take a piece of tape and put your name on it, and we're gonna bring it to the oven to let it dry overnight. And then the next lab session, we will come back and reweight the filter paper now with the copper 2 oxide product in it. And the difference of that will let us know how much copper 2 oxide we obtained. All right, I'll see you later. Okay, here is our dried up filter with our copper 2 oxide product. It will be very dry and very dark. And one important thing to observe is that there shouldn't be any yellow residue on the filter paper. If there is like a yellowish color on it, it probably means that you did not rinse out the excess NaOH completely. And because of that, some of it essentially vaporized and you have residue of solid NaOH in here. This one looks very good. What I'm going to do is I'm going to bring it to the balance room. I'm going to weight that filter paper with the copper 2 oxide product, and I'm going to go ahead and do my calculations.